Hi, everyone. Welcome to the Critical Zone Observatory Network's webinar series, Critical Zone in Society. Just to note, this webinar will be recorded. We welcome today Susan Brantley, PI of the Susquehanna Shale Hills CZO and Distinguished Professor in the Department of Geosciences at Penn State University. Sue will be kicking off the series today with the most critical zone problems. And with that, I'll pass it over to you, Sue.
Well, thank you. I'm pleased to give this first of the series of talks in the Critical Zone in the Society series. And I think this is a good way to start because this is really not a talk, it's more of a conversation. And hopefully it'll be kind of a good kickoff. What I'm interested in talking about is what do we as critical zone scientists think are the most critical zone problems? So let's look at that in terms of a conversation. Just to remind everybody, the critical zone is the ever-changing layer of Earth's surface that goes from vegetation canopy to the depths of groundwater. And in the United States, the Critical Zones Observatory Program has been funded by National Science Foundation to look at how the critical zone operates, how it has evolved, how it is evolving, and the dynamics of the critical zone today. And the way this program operates, the NSF has funded 9 critical zone observatories, and Bill Dietrich has conceptualized this as a quilt. This is supposed to be a quilt showing the 9 different observatories, and he put them out according to or across environmental gradients of precipitation on the bottom and erosion rate, and then you can see they're color-coded by the lithology. And this idea of a quilt gives you a little bit of an impetus to think about the critical zone as exactly this. It's laid out across environmental gradients, and there are different lithologies that then manifest the response to the energy and mass fluxes that are occurring at Earth's surface. And critical zone science is the study of this thing. And again, Bill Dietrich has really emphasized that we need to think of the critical zone as a thing. We're very good at splitting up the thing into hydrology or into geochemistry or geomorphology or ecology and studying sort of those aspects of the thing. But the critical zone science idea is that we study this thing as a thing. And seeing it in its entirety stretches us in ways that are exciting. The thought of critical zone science, the idea of it, really has taken off. This is some statistics that Suzanne Anderson put together. You know, the top is the number of publication per year with the keywords critical zones from 2007 to 2016. You can see how it's really been growing quickly. And then on the right, the published works per research area with the reference term critical zone. This is just using the Web of Science or ISI. And you really see that the idea of the critical zone has been taking off. And it's not just in the United States, of course, it's also in Europe, in China, in Australia, and indeed around the world into South America. So here's what our observatory network looks like in 2016 in the US. You can see the 9 observatories. Some of them have more than one footprint, like the Jemez River and the Santa Catalina. This is the way we are investigating this thing, this critical zone today in the US. So what do I mean when I say what are the most critical zone problems? So what is a critical zone problem? I'm suggesting that it's a problem for humans and for ecosystems in general. It's a problem that heavily involves the solid Earth surface from vegetation canopy to groundwater. It's a problem that incorporates physical, chemical, and biological aspects of the Earth's surface. So that would include anthropogenic aspects. This obviously means that each problem would involve many perspectives. So it really is a critical zone perspective because it brings all the different disciplines to the table. And then finally, one piece of the critical zone that we really emphasize all the time is that we are looking at the critical zone across a variety of timescales, from the timescale of the meteorologist to the timescale of the geologist. And that by looking at the critical zone as a thing across all these timescales, we gain more knowledge and more understanding that we wouldn't otherwise. And so I think we need to think of critical zone problems in this same way, in that we're trying to understand them across timescales, not just the human timescale, but the timescale of sort of the geological underpinning or even the very quick meteorological timescale. Well, we've been discussing this in various venues for a while. Suzanne Anderson and I ran a conversation at a Goldschmidt conference, which I think was in 2013. I have to go back and figure that out exactly, but this, to the best as I can remember, it was 2013. And we suggested that these 10 topics here might be the most critical zone problems for humans. And the conversation was really interesting at that time. And we changed some of them. And for example, the last one, maintaining environmental beauty, it was pointed out to us something which is obvious, namely that beauty is in the eye of the beholder, and that maybe we're not really trying to maintain beauty so much as maintain the diversity of different environments, since beauty, you know, really depends on what you see as beautiful. So anyway, we're going to talk through in this conversation, this talk today, you know, a new rendition of those problems as sort of we've conceived them today. But before we do that, let's look at some other related concepts. So first of all, ecosystem services. Some of the other talks in this series are going to be about ecosystem services and the idea of critical zone services, which has been espoused in a paper in 2015 by Field et al. So ecosystem services are benefits to humans that are derived from ecosystems. And this, you know, the left side of the slide just talks about how they can be provisioning surfaces, regulating surfaces, supporting surfaces, and cultural surfaces. And this is just from Wikipedia. But this is a very current idea that's important in terms of what do humans get in a benefit sense from ecosystems. And then what Field et al. Have done in a nice paper is they look at this from a critical zone perspective by extending the context of ecosystem services to expressly include the physical structure of the terrestrial Earth and try to give the critical zone services more of a broader spatial and temporal template in terms of thinking about ecosystem services. And as I said, there'll be a talk about this in this series. Other related concepts are natural hazards. Natural hazards are phenomena that might have a negative effect on people or on the environment, and these are natural phenomena once again. And so we think of things like earthquakes, volcanism, wildfires, floods, droughts, coastal erosions. So natural hazards would be another related concept. And then just to remind you, what I'm trying to propose here is that we can think about critical zone problems and try to pick the most critical zone problems as being those that impact humans and other biota, those that are restricted to the Earth's surface from vegetation canopy to groundwater, problems that are, you know, multidisciplinary in terms of how you have to approach them, and then problems that can span multiple timescales, or that at least it benefits us to think about them by thinking through different timescales because we'll understand them better. So when you start trying to put down your top 10 most critical zone problems, you know, you can get kind of balled up. Should something like climate change be on the list? Is it a problem or is it a driver? You know, you could also think about deforestation. Is that a problem or is it a driver? And as I said, this is a conversation. This is not a talk. This is not a published paper. So we're still in the process of thinking through the answers to these questions. Another thing that, you know, kind of gotten balled up thinking about is how specific or how general should the most critical zone problems be? You know, should we be talking about water scarcity, or should we be much more specific and talk about groundwater depletion, since groundwater depletion really sort of then all of a sudden gets into the crust of the Earth, the sort of physical Earth structure part of the critical zone? Should we be talking about water degradation, or would we want to talk about something like arsenic mobilization, since arsenic is a really important water quality problem, and a lot of the arsenic that it's creating the problem is coming out of rocks. So that's, you know, a bona fide critical zone problem. Should we be USA-centric or should we be world-focused? And then how much overlap should there be among the problems? So anyway, to start this conversation in terms of specifics, here's a new version of the most critical zone issues or problems. And now all of a sudden there's 12. I do think they need to be pared down. I think 10 or 9 would be better. But in this talk now, I'm going to zip through these, and I'm going to go really fast. I put a lot of slides together, not so that I could lecture you about these different problems, but so that you just get a sense of what I'm talking about and then give us enough time at the end to talk about them, to actually converse. So the first one, soil degradation. This would include loss of nutrients, loss of soil itself, desertification. You can see a picture in Kenya of desertification that's ongoing. And, you know, desertification has really been identified as one of the big problems worldwide. You can see some of the statistics about it and how it's affecting agriculture, even in the face of growing populations. Desertification occurs when the trees and plant cover are removed, when there's animal grazing that erodes the topsoil, when there's intensive farming that depletes the nutrients, wind and water erosion. And so this, I think, is a bona fide critical zone problem. Here's some facts and figures, a lot of information about this because of the focus at the level of the UN on desertification. Something like 40% of the Earth's surface is arid or semi-arid, and these are the regions that are vulnerable to desertification. And, you know, when you think about it in terms of relationships to humans, 74% or so of the poor are directly affected by such land degradation globally. So obviously from a worldwide point of view, desertification is a bona fide critical zone problem. Water scarcity and groundwater depletion. On a global scale, we have plenty of total of water, but really the problem is the availability of the water and the purity of their water and where that water is. And in this paper by Jury and Vo in 2007, they make this point that for the first time in human history, human use and pollution of fresh water have reached a level where scarcity of the water will potentially limit food production, will limit ecosystem function, and will limit urban supply. And obviously this is connected to the growth in human population. But they also make the point that perhaps the greatest threat in terms of freshwater scarcity is to terrestrial ecosystems. In other words, you know, we'll be able to move water around and get water and clean water for ourselves, but there'll be big impact on ecosystems. Just some more information, largely from the paper by Jury and Vo. You can see different categories of water, blue water and green water. And then just some facts and figures about global water runoff and how much of that runoff is available. And so, you know, thinking about these kinds of problems are, you know, obviously connecting all the different subdisciplines and clearly also involving the physical Earth surface itself. And here's a plot of annual consumption of fresh water per year and with projections forward out to 2025. And clearly that the annual consumption of water is high enough and the supply of water that I had some numbers about in the previous slide are close enough to some of these numbers that we are looking at significant impacts into the future, both to humans and to ecosystems itself. Just some information about groundwater. Nearly half the population in the U.S. drinks groundwater. And although there's a huge amount of groundwater, and you can see the values here kind of compared to the Mississippi, as we are pulling down more and more groundwater and not replacing it, there's really significant questions about groundwater depletion as a critical zone problem into the future. This is a paper published in 2012 showing some groundwater depletion compared to estimates, and then just a little bit of data from the Ogallala, which is one of the most problematic of the supplies and of the groundwater. Of the groundwater formations in the U.S. that underlies most of Nebraska, much of Colorado, Kansas, Texas, the Oklahoma Panhandle. And it's a very large water source for a very huge agriculture area, as you can see some of the statistics on this slide. And the water in the Ogallala was recharged during the retreat of the ice sheets, and now the recharge is much less, 20 inches per year. We've been mining this water, and the water tables have dropped. So this is obviously something that could be in our wheelhouse in terms of critical zone science. So now beyond water scarcity, there's also water quality issues. Water pollution itself is a leading cause of death worldwide. A couple of categories of pollutants are shown: pathogens, agricultural nutrients, pesticides, industrial emissions of chemicals, and then natural toxics such as arsenic. And there's even interest in these very persistent compounds, the dirty dozen, that are found up even in the Arctic that really don't break down quickly at all, and that really lodge in ice and critical zone materials. Waste disposal is a piece of this, and you know, this could be considered a critical zone problem, but it's, again, I thought of it more as a driver. It's something that causes water quality degradation. You can just see some of the huge amounts of waste that is produced, and think of this in terms of landfills and then smaller chemical spills everywhere. Another one is flooding. Really disastrous floods are common every year. This is something that Californians are very not aware of at the moment this year, billions of dollars a year. Coastal flooding, the chance of it is increasing as sea level rises, but flooding throughout the continents is also possible. Many things that we do actually lead to the flooding or exacerbate the flooding: logging, farming, urbanization, building in floodplains, and then even some of the engineering techniques that we use to control floods create more flooding. So flooding is, to me anyway, clearly one of the most critical zone problems. Landsliding is another one that to me seems like an obvious critical zone problem and one of the top 10 or 12 most critical zone problems. Landslides occur in all states. The most affected are California, Oregon, and Washington, but any mountainous and hilly area, but there are also landslides in less mountainous, less hilly areas. You can see that, again, it's billions of dollars of damage per year in the U.S. and kills people every year as well. And then this is just an image from a paper in 2015 showing giant landslides even in low gradient landscapes. Fire, another putative, most critical zone problem. Question of whether fire is becoming more frequent now. Fire impacts climate, it impacts the water cycle locally and then sometimes regionally, and it also impacts biogeochemical cycling. You can see really nice diagram from Ward et al. 2012, just, you know, that really kind of emphasizes sort of the impact of fire. Also, fire is thought to impact carbon storage. So many of the biogeochemical cycle issues that are around soil organic carbon are impacted in ways that we don't necessarily know. And then this was just from a paper, again, by Ward et al. 2012, that simulated the effects of fire on carbon sequestration and carbon storage. Deforestation, just a recent paper even that was in the New York Times this week about, you know, how we can think about deforestation. The top two maps are observed forest cover in the quantified in the way that it had been quantified in the past. And then a paper this week, the authors you can see at the bottom, we're quantifying not so much by forest cover the way it was in A and B at the top, but more by the distance to another forest, so sort of connectivity of forests. And the authors were arguing that this is important in terms of understanding impacts from a critical zone science point of view. Problems related to deforestation, habitat fragmentation, release of carbon in the atmosphere, soil erosion, soil carbon storage issues, impact on water vapor exchange, and loss of species. Another one that I'm very interested in, a little bit different than some of the others that I've mentioned, is maintaining environmental diversity. I'm arguing that when we first wrote this, Suzanne Anderson and I had it as maintaining sort of environmental beauty, but it was pointed out to us, of course, that beauty's in the eye of the beholder. And so I kind of thought about it, and I think really what we're talking about is finding a way to maintain diversity of environments. And just shown here, you got Pennsylvania in the upper left, and then the upper middle is a shale barrens, which is known to host very unusual biota. And then on the right, I think, is the Sierra Mountains, Sierra Nevada, from the Southern Sierra, and then the Melange at the bottom from Eel River. And what I'm arguing here is that the diversity of landscapes that we have is actually something that we need to maintain from a human health point of view, mental health. I'm thinking just, you know, people using the outdoors as recreation and a way of feeling better. But then also there's evidence from
biologists that maintaining diversity is a way, maintaining environmental diversity, meaning geologic and elevation and, you know, other characteristics, is a way of maintaining biodiversity. This is an interesting paper by Mark Anderson of the Nature Conservancy, just looking at habitats in the Northeast and trying to, you know, map different species onto different habitats like shale barrens, and arguing that that really the Nature Conservancy needs to be buying up environmental diversity in order to maintain biological diversity. And this is kind of related, that again, this is from that same paper. This is the ratio of conversion of landscapes to securement of those kinds of landscape as a function or plotted versus the percent of the region. And this is just a way of thinking about, are we really preserving the different kinds of landscapes that we have, or are we tending to preserve only certain kinds of landscapes, like maybe high montane landscapes, when we should be, if we want to maintain biodiversity and a healthy planet, maybe we need to be maintaining things like shale barrens that people don't necessarily think of as the beautiful landscapes. Wetlands, the rate of loss of wetlands as a critical zone problem. I'm not gonna read through the 10 different wetlands sort of values or ecosystem services of wetlands. I'm not gonna read the definition of wetlands. You can read all of those, but we've lost half of the world's wetlands in the last 100 years, especially in the northern countries. And this impacts water supply, regulation of water, flood, saline intrusion in groundwater, erosion. A lot of this is due to conversion for agriculture, but this seems like a critical zone problem to me. Another one of these CZ problems is issues related to energy development and mining. I just have two pictures of Pennsylvania, since I live here. On the left are all the known oil and gas wells in the state. There's more than 300,000, maybe 100,000 of them. We don't even know where they are. On the right are all the coal mines of the state. And again, there's something like tens of thousands of them where we don't even know where those mines are. So the development for oil and gas and for mining have huge impacts. I think that acid mine drainage is considered by the US EPA to be the largest source of pollution on a river kilometer basis in the US. And then mining itself moves more than 50 billion metric tons of geological material per year. This is similar to the flux of particles by rivers. So we have huge impact in terms of energy development and mining. And I think this deserves to be one of our most critical zone problems. Another one is urban sprawl. I kind of debated if this is a driver or a problem, but I have it in here as one of the problems. We can talk about that. You can look at some of the data here. According to 2004, from 95 to 2030, there'd be 2.5 billion more people on the planet, of which 2.44 would live in urban centers. And clearly our CZOs right now in the US are not designed to understand urbanization. And it's not just urbanization, it's megacities. And you can see that table at the bottom showing the growth of these really large megacities. Here's urban percent of population versus year growing. And I think this is something that the CZO network, as we've got it designed now, does not take into account. And to me, this urban growth, urbanization, is a critical zone problem. Urban areas increase runoff, nutrient losses, losses of oil and grease, and heavy metals, just as some of the easy impacts to list. Landscape fragmentation, a bunch of slides here all from Pennsylvania. We're putting pipelines all over Pennsylvania. Again, this is a map of Pennsylvania with the pipelines that are going in. Fragmentation of landscape occurs when contiguous areas are subdivided, and so this breaks up a habitat and makes more edge habitat and less core habitat, and this has big impact on certain species. Roads can also can fragment landscapes. A lot of roads that are going in to develop oil and gas in Pennsylvania, for example, are causing fragmentation. And the results can be seen in changes in species composition and abundance, spread of invasive species, disturbance of sensitive habitats, and negative effects on biodiversity that we can see in the data, just even since 2004 in Pennsylvania. This is just some data from Margaret Brittingham, who's been looking at this in Pennsylvania as the very fast oil and gas development in the last several years. So let me just finish. I don't actually know what time it is anymore. 3:34. Okay, that's going to give us some good time for conversation, so that's great. I kind of want to finish by talking about or thinking about what's the place of CZOs with respect to these problems, and what can CZOs do that smaller projects or other models of science cannot, and I'm hoping that we'll have a conversation about this. We've thought a little bit about what CZOs do that other models of science do not. One is that at CZOs, we synthesize interdisciplinary activities. So it seems that if we could identify the most critical zone problems that are very interdisciplinary, the CZOs might be perfect places to address some of these. Second, CZOs act as platforms for cross-site measurements and integrative ideas. The same measurement is made at all sites and new understanding emerges. So some of these problems might be amenable to study even across different CZOs. CZOs act as baseline. Certainly some of the most critical zone problems that I mentioned can be thought of as catastrophic events, so floods or landslides. And at critical zone observatories, where you have longstanding measurements before the event, this allows then measurements after the event and look at timescales of recovery. And I'm thinking about fires that have heard in, that have happened in the Hemez, CZO, and then the flood in Boulder Creek, just as examples. CZOs act as stimuli that push process-based understanding. I think in many ways, really the observatories are the site of process-based understanding. And so when we identify these most critical zone problems, and what I mean by that again is like the problems that are affecting humans, I think that we often need process-based understanding in order to predict likelihood or predict recovery after any of these problems. And I think CZOs are well positioned to do that. CZOs act as foci for fundamental observations that can lead to global testing. So sometimes the CZOs can be almost like a little test bed for some sensors or instrumentation or an approach, and then it can move out globally. I'd like to think in Pennsylvania we could learn ways to think about the shale gas and the habitat fragmentation that I showed you in some slides, and then have those ideas move away globally. CZOs act as teachers, sort of institutional teachers about societal problems in terms of education and outreach. And so, from a clear teaching point of view, these problems that we are facing that are critical zone based are things that we should be teaching about. And then the CZOs act as incubators so the junior scientists could think across disciplines and then move on from the CZOs to become faculty members or scientists in other parts of the world. So I'm open to any conversation as to which problems are the most critical of the critical zone problems. And also just how we should embrace these in terms of the critical zone observatories as we move them into the future, and a critical zone observatory network. And this is very pertinent because sometime in the summer and fall, we expect NSF to come out with an RFP for the critical zone observatories or for critical zone science. And so this is the kind of thinking that might affect that movement forward. And then we also have a meeting in June in Arlington that we're encouraging people to sign up for, where we're also going to talk about what the critical zone science of the future is going to look like. So let's open it up to some questions. So each speaker apparently can unmute themselves and ask a question. So we just need some courageous person to unmute themselves and ask a question. So someone wrote me, should the criteria to be on the list be anthropogenic issues? I think so. I maybe didn't make that clear. Here's how I define the critical zone problems. I meant it's a problem for humans and for ecosystems in general, but I did mean to emphasize humans. I guess we could talk about whether a critical zone problem that was just a problem for ecosystems and wasn't a problem for humans should be on the list. But that might even be philosophical, because if it's a problem for ecosystems, I bet it's a problem for humans. Oh, so Charlie is asking, should that be the only criterion? Not sure exactly what you mean, because I was emphasizing the fact that these are critical zone problems. And to make them critical zone problems, I was emphasizing that they would heavily involve the solid earth surface from vegetation to groundwater, and that it would be incorporating physical, chemical, biological aspects. And then also, I think we need to invite and be interested in problems in all timescales. So we're looking for an intrepid person to unmute and ask us a question. Suzanne, I see you're out there. Can't you unmute and ask yourself a question?
I just figured out how to unmute.
Oh my goodness, technology, what are we gonna do?
Okay, I just unmuted. Well, it's very interesting. It seems to me that many of these issues are ones that sort of gain their currency because of many of our sort of rapid processes, and knowing how these anthropogenic issues, many of them are caused by humans or very strong impacts on humans, how they impact us has to do with what is the rate that would be going on in the absence of humans. And I feel like one of the things we offer is the latter perspective. How does the system work absent human intervention? And then nonetheless, I think it's important and useful to then ask, what are people doing? How can the system respond to these changes? I'm thinking, for instance, of say the mining moving lots of sediment. How long does it take to regenerate the soils that might be done? So I really want to make sure that we don't lose the attention to the background rates of these processes. That's one point. And second point is, I think that almost every site we could look at and ask, in what ways are we looking at a natural system and in what ways are we not? And I think we were just reviewed, and the comment was that, well, only two of the CZO sites in the U.S. are ones that are have these anthropogenic influences. And then I think about the Boulder Creek watershed, which has mining in it, which has dams and reservoirs and diversions of water, which has had at least two human-caused wildfires in the last 10 years. And it's, you know, has nitrogen deposition going on in the rainfall. It has an urban setting. The Boulder Creek runs through the city of Boulder. How could we be really viewed as being just a pristine site? I think we could all think about our sites in those ways.
Suzanne.
Yes.
Okay, I just wasn't sure you could hear me. I think those are two really good points, really good points. You know, I don't actually think we should all of a sudden start just worrying about soil degradation. I think you're completely right on. That what we're, you know, what we can bring to the table is an understanding of the process level and sort of the resilience and the rate of change or the rate of response after a perturbation. And so I think that your first comment was right on target in that respect. And I think that I definitely don't want to mean that this is all we should think about, but I kind of wanted to start thinking about what are the most critical of the problems that we think that are important, and we wanted to be thinking about whether we're addressing them. And then your second point that, you know, each system is both impacted and natural, I think is also right on target and really speaks to that first point as well. So doesn't somebody hate some of the ones on my list and want to tell me that I'm wrong? I think if you hover your cursor over the slide at the top or the bottom, it tells you how to unmute. Okay, someone has suggested human health. Okay, so this is bad pedagogy, but I'm gonna now say why I wouldn't include human health. I mean, I do think human health is definitely impacted by critical zone processes for sure, but I wouldn't say that human health is like a critical zone problem in the way that I had defined it. But human health, certainly, I think you could argue, is impacted either directly or indirectly by all these different problems. Okay, Jesse Young Robertson wrote, she's thinking about areas for future CZOs where human density is sparse. Yeah, I think that'd be interesting. Steve Holbrook, can't you unmute your thing, Steve? I'll read you, but it would be much better for you to speak. Steve writes, I worry about losing the identity of the CZO program with this list, which seems like a grab bag of nearly everything that happens in the near surface. Are we losing a sense of the CZ as a thing? I think that's a really useful comment. I worried about that myself. Steve is shy. Oh, dear. Yeah, I worried about that myself. You know, I wanted to keep it Earth surface focused, but then somehow I kept getting pulled into putting things like deforestation on there and wetland destruction on there. Yeah, I don't know. What do other people think about shy Steve's thinking? Okay, Sharon thinks they're interdisciplinary, which I think is true. I didn't realize everybody in this community was so shy. I specifically made this short so that people would actually
talk. Okay, Sue, I'll unmute. Can you guys hear me?
This must be brave, Steve.
I thought you would appreciate that comment, Sue. Just to take a counter point of view, I mean, all of these things are obviously important and require interdisciplinary research and could benefit from a CZO network, but I just worry if we're thinking towards the June meeting and how the CZ program is going to be reconstituted into something. I think one of the great advantages that the CZO program has brought to the table is the creation of, I mean, you had it in your first slide, I think, the creation of this idea that the critical zone is a thing. It's a system of interlocking processes that together create something that, in my personal definition, is not that it goes to the deep groundwater, but that it's everything whose bulk chemical and physical properties are different by virtue of connection to the Earth's surface. And I just worry about how we would cast this. We're going to study everything from floods to forest fires to wetlands to the Ogallala. I don't know. It just seems like we risk losing the core of it somehow.
Sue, can you hear me?
Yes, I can. Who is this?
This is Marty Goldhaber.
Hey, Marty.
How are you?
Good. Nice to talk with you.
Yeah. So one concept that you flashed by in one of your slides that I think may help to tie together some of the background processes with and natural processes with the kind of anthropogenic impacts is the concept of services. And you put up a slide that showed that critical zone services are a more comprehensive way of thinking about what's provided to us by nature compared to ecosystem services because of the focus on the more comprehensive critical zone concept. And I think by understanding critical zone processes and thinking of them in terms of services provides a way of linking kind of the natural processes and superimposing what I think in the past you might have called earth casting.
Do you know what that is?
Kind of looking at the critical role that forecasting and how it links to these processes plays.
That's a great comment too. I put up the slide you're talking about, and that gives me a chance to say that the next one in this series where we're gonna have no technological problems is on March 14, and it's gonna be exactly about critical zone services, and it's gonna be David Brashears and Jason Field from the University of Arizona. So that is another way of thinking about this. And I think that's another, you know, kind of rationale or prism through which to look at the CZO observatory. So I think, you know, that might resonate with some of you more. Back to Steve's comment. I of course don't know the answer. And I didn't necessarily mean that these critical problems would be the only thing that any of us would work on. I guess what I was thinking about was, you know, what are the things that society is most worried about in terms of the thing that we're studying? And I don't mean it as a way to torque the whole CZO process. And I think if we did if we pushed or discussed critical zone services, I don't think that should torque the whole critical zone observatory network or process either. But I think these are just different prisms through which to look at this endeavor that we're engaged in. At least that's how I'm thinking about it, but let's hear from more people. Jill Marshall is also shy, and she says that, I don't think Jill Marshall is shy, by the way, but she thinks a globalist is hard because not all issues are the most important everywhere. I think that's definitely right on target. By the way, someone logged in and said that there's internet problems all over the internet right now, including Amazon. So that made us feel much better here, because I don't know what happened. There's just been internet problems here that never happens. Okay, why don't we get another comment here? No? Somebody want to unmute? Who's Hi. Out there?
This is Dave Brashears.
Hey, great. Log in.
I'm here with Jason Field, and just to link this talk and maybe preview a little bit about what we'll try and talk about in the next seminar. So my background is more of an ecosystem ecologist, and so, you know, we've been interested in the concept of ecosystem services for some time, and that's a really rich, developed literature. And as we were trying to think about What does this concept of critical zone services mean? And in particular, especially from colleagues maybe closer to our own field, getting a lot of pushback about what are some of the distinctions. You know, isn't this already all covered in ecosystem services? And so it took a lot of iteration, a lot of discussion. And what's on the slide is one of three things that we came up with that we'll try and highlight next week. But in that paper, we talk about context that a CZO can provide, constraints that are listed on that particular slide, and currencies in terms of evaluation. So I will just say that it's hard to sort of isolate this, and we backed off of trying to say this is sort of distinct and really tried to focus on what's the added value that sort of a critical zone perspective brings on top of sort of what's already being established in terms of ecosystem services in general.
Yeah, I like that. I have to say, to me, the ecosystems, as I'm a geologist, the ecosystem services concept is kind of foreign, which is not to say that I haven't read about it, learned about it, that I don't embrace it. I do. But it's just kind of a foreign way of thinking to me as a geologist. And so I guess what I was thinking with the critical zone problems was just a little different way of looking at things, not because I think it's better or right and the other one's wrong or worse, but because, I don't know, we're kind of circling around this enterprise that we're doing, trying to think about how to make the enterprise move forward in the most, I'd say, exciting way. That would be the adjective I would use. But I haven't published a paper on this like David and Jason have. It's just something I've been thinking about and I thought would be kind of interesting to talk through.
You know, yeah, it's a great, that's not to say that list is not a great list for discussion. I was just kind of trying to convey some of the challenges we had in trying to think through this from a CZ perspective, and then also going through the peer review process and sort of, you know, dealing with different responses from different parts of the community in terms of how we say things and how strongly we emphasize different things.
Yeah, sorry, I didn't mean my comment to sound defensive or whatever. I thought your comment was great. And I really liked what you guys did. Again, it's just different ways of looking at the elephant. Let's see what Jory Schultz says here. What about focusing on potential solutions to these issues rather than the problems? What works best in answering the problem? Yeah, in some ways, that's what Rich Yurtich from NSF said to us at one of the meetings where I presented some of these ideas. You know, he said that, why does everything always have to be bad? Why can't we look at it from the point of view of, you know, improving situations as opposed to problems? So that might be a very good comment, Jory. That might be a better way to oppose it in terms of NSF. And in terms of, I don't know, thinking about future funding. Anybody else shyly waiting to talk?
I'm a shy person. This is Suzanne again. I have to take off here in just 1 minute. But thinking about positive ways to present these issues, it seems like we could focus on resilience. And resilience means ability to bounce back after the assault of something like soil degradation or landsliding or urban sprawl or whatever. And again, it requires understanding what is the system response, what is the system behavior in the absence of these assaults. It's a bad word for it, assault, but you know what I mean. Okay, I gotta leave, so thank you very much for this, Sue.
Thank you. I think we're getting to the end of our time here. Any last comments here from anyone? I see people are starting to run.
Hello.
Hello.
Hello. I'm Andre Eagle from New Zealand, and I just had something I'm looking at here a little bit. So like soil degradation, we're looking at land use and the effects of land use and the detrimental effects mostly. But these are mostly effects like, you know, short-term things like a nitrogen leaching or things like that. But little has been done about long-term effects on the, let's say, the soil system by agriculture, and it's probably something that could be focused as well, because it looks at the more stable and slowly changing properties of soils, for example. But it also looks at maybe even good effects that are imposed by agriculture, for example, some ways to increase the organic carbon content. So I'm just thinking that these more long-term effects, these century kind of timescales things, should be not forgotten. But I think they often are, because, we're looking at nitrogen a lot, then phosphorus maybe, and all these pollutants, but not so much about, long-term effects on clay mineralogy, for example, or, absorption capacity of soils and so forth.
I like that comment, Andre, that I think it kind of resonates a little bit with something that Suzanne mentioned, this the time scale. That most of the things that I talked about were fairly short time scale, or there were human impacts over years or decades. But one of the things that CZOs could actually be looking at is the you know, implications of, you know, long-term effects related to some of the change that humans are imposing on the environment. And I think that's a, I think that's a really interesting comment to think about, because that definitely plays with the critical zone idea that we're interested in, processes at all timescales, from the meteorological to the geological. And so thinking about problems that we normally think of on short timescales, but thinking about them over longer timescales, definitely would be in our wheelhouse, and definitely should be something that should be articulated if we do talk about the most critical zone problems. So that, I like that comment.
So there would be kind of a real sustainability, and not just the kind of politician kind of length.
Yeah, exactly.
Sustainability.
Exactly. So Paul Brooks writes, I'm struck by the synergy between a list of issues presented here as well as others, and the attempts to group challenges and implicitly the related solutions associated with concepts of ecosystem services or critical zone services. Right. Yeah, I do think that we're circling around a lot of the same things and thinking about it in different ways. I think we've come to the end of our time and people are starting to leave. And I think Tim White may break in and say this, but I'll just start to say it. He wants to thank everybody for your participation and your patience. Don't blame Penn State for that internet stuff. I think that was like, maybe it was all over the US, I don't know. Please plan to join us for the second webinar, March 14, Critical Zone Services. And you'll hear David Brashears and Jason Field. I think that'll be a very stimulating conversation. That will probably be more of a talk, a normal talk, because they've written a paper about this. And what I was trying to do is really crowdsource this as a way to think about the enterprise that we're on in terms of problems. So thanks everybody very much. Send me an email if you want to, have more conversation. Thanks a lot. And thank you, Sarah. You're a gem. Okay, bye.